You both are early.
I don't see anyone in here for the emerging, so let's talk a little bit about your worlds. You both are on are on mute.
Sorry, I was waiting for this to open to end and decided to make another little call. I thought I had long enough to make a call.
Oh, I mean, we're 15 minutes early, so if you want to come back in 15 minutes, or we can be here.
Yeah, I'm just gonna put me on mute, whatever.
Okay, so we'll start at 10:30. Jan, okay. Are you there? Jan, you want to talk about your question from earlier?
Okay, I'm going to get off so Jan can talk about her question.
Okay. Are you there? All right. Let me know if you can hear me, and I can answer your question now if you'd like. Hey.
Oh, sorry.
That's okay.
I had minimized it for a second. Can you hear me?
Yeah, let me hang up the phone call.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay. So here's my challenge, and I guess it's a good thing it happened now, so I have time to deal with it. I have a mortgage lender. It's for an investor who wants 30 days financing contingency with an automatic 15 day, not 7 days, unilateral extension.
So this is the investor that wants that, or a lender?
The lender. And he's a real ass, to put it nicely.
And the investor was the one that wants to use this lender?
Well, unfortunately, all the hard money's dried up, so he has few choices, and this is one of them. And of course, he was referred by his cousin who has used this lender down in Florida. But I mean, Bill, the guy, I told him I needed proof of funds.
Yeah.
He reamed me out for 15 minutes and told me basically what an idiot I was. And he'd been in this business and for 30 years. And, you know, he's never had to provide proof of funds. And I didn't know what the hell I was talking about. So I finally got him to send it to me. He sends me an email. He says he's qualified up to X and, you know, whatever. I'm like, really?
Is that proof of funds, or it just him writing a note?
That's just him writing a note. I mean, and based on he's telling me, it says that be advised that our office is working with JF Management for his purchase acquisition. The above LLC qualifies for up to $350,000 for each purchase transaction. This is subject to complete underwriting and must conform to our underwriting guidelines. Are you there?
Yeah, okay. I'm here.
Okay.
So here's what I think. I think that you're in charge, and I think you set the standards for when you work with somebody and when you don't. And that's not proof of funds. So, sir, here's the story. If you want to work with me, I need proof of funds. And this is what constitutes proof of funds. I'm not submitting any offers on your behalf without proof of funds, because they're all going to be ignored. Because the expectation is that proof of funds are submitted with an offer. And that's final. And until you can work under those circumstances, you'll need to work with a different agent.
Okay.
So, and there's no way in hell I would have let somebody ream me out for 15 minutes. I said, stop. I'm going to treat you with a level of professional respect, and you're going to treat me the same way. And the moment you violate that, sir, we're done. Are we clear?
Okay.
And one of two things is going to happen. He's either going to totally flip and say, oh my gosh, I'm working with a real professional here, which I probably wouldn't bet on, or he's going to, not be respectful, in which case you don't want to work with somebody like that, and you should spend that newfound time prospecting somebody different.
Gotcha. Well, let's just say for in the interest that we move forward.
Okay.
He has asked, because I agree with you, he's asked for this 30-day financing contingency with a 15-day unilateral extension. How do I resolve that?
I would call the lender and say couple things. Number one is, here's what's standard, right? And here's what sellers will typically agree to. And let me guess, he's buying homes in like the sub 200 neighborhood, right?
Yes.
Okay, so it's going to be super competitive. And this is what is pretty much common practice. And so I just need to share a few things with you. Number one, is there any way that you can do this? And then you can put in the COVID stip, which is common now, right? That might protect them against some of the challenges that you're referring to. right? And say, if the contract read like this with the COVID stip with typical contingency periods, would you feel that your client is protected? Could you agree to those terms? And they'll say yes, and then you can move on. Or they'll say no, and you say, I need you to understand that I'm more than happy to submit offers that have these facts in them, just like you're proposing, but I need you to understand, and I need your client to understand, that it's uncommon in this marketplace, and it's unlikely to be accepted.
Okay.
So I will submit them for you, and I'm just curious, how many of these are we going to need to lose before you start listening to me?
Yeah, it's this is a weird situation. He wants him to be under contract before basically he's going to do anything. But, you know, he has to be pre-approved. It doesn't matter where he goes. He's got to be pre-approved. You know, he's got
to
have.
It's not even something you need to be thinking about. The fact it's in order for him to work with you, you're going to set certain standards. So maybe he'll work with it. Maybe somebody will run around town entertaining his needs, but it shouldn't be you. Say, look, I just show me something. You can cross out all the account numbers if you want, that says that the man has X number of dollars in the bank. And if you don't want to show that the account's got $5 million in it when you're only buying a $200,000 house, then show me a different number. Show me that like a sub account's got $300,000 in it or whatever.
Well, but that's not it. It's hard money lending. You know, 75% plus all of the renovation is provided by the hard money lender.
So it's not proof of funds in cash. It's a pre-qualification letter, right?
Yes.
So why are we talking about proof of funds?
Well, we have to provide proof of funds and get pre-qualification. And the lender just doesn't want to, you know, that's what he said. He sent me an email. He didn't even send me a letterhead. But beyond that, my question is how to write up the contract with what the lender wants.
You put it in there as a step. Or whatever time period you need, and rather than the 8-day unilateral, you say seller shall grant per paragraph 12 or whatever paragraph it is. Rather than an 8-day unilateral, it'll be a 15-day unilateral that both parties have an opportunity to use. You just amend the contract as needed, but the important thing there is, like, let's say it's a pre-approval and the loan is 20% or 25%. I'm sorry, the down payment is 20 or 25%. We never show proof of funds for that 20%. We just show the pre-approval letter. So you shouldn't have to show the cash or you're just getting a pre-approval letter.
Part of the problem is I don't have a pre-approval letter. But that's
neat. Well, there you go. That's
work on that. I'm just trying to get the contract written up. I can get around all of that. I can work on that part of it. The other piece of this equation is this is a property that's in probate. So how do I handle that by putting my client in the best light?
I would say that no time periods begin until the seller can furnish appropriate documentation saying that the seller has full authority to sell this home. Okay. Kind of like short sale approval, right? No time period shall begin until a lender approves of the sale. Or, you know, buyer and seller agree that the financing contingency, the due diligence, and the appraisal contingency shall not begin until seller provides full approval in writing, so that verifying that that this property can in fact be sold by the seller.
Okay. Then The other issue is there are some other offers on this house. I'm sure they're all substantially lower than what the asking price is due to the nature of the repairs on the home. So have you, you know, like sometimes we send a love letter to sellers to try to get our property approved. Should I send a scope of work with this or a letter to our offer?
A letter to justify the low price?
Yes.
Honestly, I probably wouldn't bother. I think it's a huge reach, to be honest. I don't want to stop you, but they probably know the condition of the home.
Well, it's a probate attorney or probate.
So don't. So send it. So, hey, just you may not know the condition of this property, but I want to share it with you. Right. Here's the issue we're faced with. You got $80,000 worth of crap that you need to tend to. So the only person buying it's an investor. Here we are. Sign.
Okay. And should that be made as part an exhibit to the offer or just a letter?
Just a letter.
Okay. All right, Phil, that's all I needed.
Cool. All right. So the 10:30 session has begun.
What is that?
This is a session for growth agents. Growth agents we defined as people that are 11 transactions or more annually. And the goal here is to get together each week. Typically, it'd be for an hour. Today, it's going to be for half an hour. And pour into you with the needs that you guys have kind of as a collective team. And it's kind of an opportunity for me to, for lack of a better way to put it, call some plays. What I mean by that is to give you some things to think about, some assignments for the week to make sure that you are, conducting the appropriate activities, that you've reported your numbers, make sure we celebrate things that are worthy of celebrating. Jan took 4 listings this last week, so let's give her
wow, awesome.
High five, couple high fives, right? And an opportunity for us to tackle things like we just tackled. Okay. What else is on your mind, guys?
So I did the shift thing, the southeast shift guy. Yesterday. I didn't do it today because I didn't get all my calls in yesterday.
Priorities. I like it.
Well, and he said, yesterday he said, you need to be making 40 calls, having 40 conversations a day.
I told you I'm being easy on you. You think I'm going crazy, but I'm actually being easy on you.
And I was struggling with all the stuff we're doing and getting my 20 calls in. So, I didn't do the 9:30 call this morning. So I got some good phone conversations.
Good. The whole point of this is, you've got to have some awareness about what's going on in your little micro business. And if you're not hitting the stats that you know you have to hit in order to hit your goals, then the only person you need to listen to is you and me.
Right.
That's it.
Okay.
All right, coach, tell us what to do.
That's right. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about that. The reason why he said 40 is because there's a lot of talk in KWRI and all these calls now that there's a chance that the market could drop by 50% in terms of unit growth. That's like saying it's raining in America, right? I mean, that doesn't necessarily tell us anything in, suburban Atlanta. However, it's eye-opening, right? We talked earlier, this is having an impact on interest rates. It's having an impact on relocation packages. It's having an impact on millions and millions of people who are losing their jobs. You know, I think that, what's the guy that works for Trump, the doctor,
Fauci?
Fauci, yeah. Mm-hmm. So I think somebody asked him yesterday if he thought that people would be able to vote in person in November. And he said, I can't guarantee that. Mm-hmm. Okay. So we have this is a big deal. Like,
do you think this will be worse than the 2008 epidemic that we went through? Because when I was listening to KCM, he seems to think it's not as bad.
It's
different.
It's different. It's like the reason why 2008 happened is because there was
financials.
A bubble and there was a financial issue. Neither one of those issues exists here. But the fact is the result of what happened as a result of there being too many people that bought homes that probably shouldn't have bought homes and prices that went up way too fast and had to come back down and people that and all the debt crisis, the result is that people lost their job, people got scared, people lost their nest eggs, their investments, and therefore everything else happened, right? The job market suffered, the stock market suffered, the real estate market suffered. So we have a little different forerunner in terms of a problem now, but the byproduct could be exactly the same, right? We just added $6 trillion to the debt,
mm-hmm.
right? Mm-hmm. Like there's a limit to how much you can do. I mean, right. Who's gonna pay for that? Right. So you got 10 million people that have just lost their job. You got these areas that the governors are trying to get together and talk about opening the economy back up little by little. But I mean, what happens when they do that and a couple weeks later their numbers creep up again? They're going to shut it back down again and the stock market's going to tank. Mm-hmm. Like the reason why they're saying, is it going to be like, or is there going to be a drop in activity? Yeah, there most likely will be. And if you want to, I forget which chapter it is in a shift, but it talks about how in a shift, if you do this much amount of work to have this much market share mm-hmm. and the market shrinks, you're going to have to do this much more work to keep your market share. Yeah, now, most of us set goals this year that we were not going to stay stagnant, right? If you sold, let's say, 20 units last year, I'm just going on a limb. Your goal was probably not to sell 20 units again. Your goal was to probably sell, I don't know, 25 or something, right? We are always wanting to grow, even if it's by a little bit. So if you want to keep your market share in a market that the actual data is going way down, right, potentially, then you're going to have to multiply your efforts. Right. And so we're not saying this to scare you, but as I've got this crew on the phone right now, there are a lot of our colleagues, and I mean real estate agents, that are not going to make it. They're just flat out not going to make it. And the only defense for that is more relationships. Right. Mm-hmm. If you want to increase the likelihood of you making it, then you need to increase the amount of relationships you have, however they come. So you don't want a cold call? I don't care. But if you don't build the number of relationships that you have, you're fooling yourself, mm-hmm. right? And so then the question becomes is, am I doing the right thing every day to increase the number of people that rely on me for real estate information and that would come to me should they have a real estate question or they have a desire to buy something or sell something? And if the answer to that is no, well, you're just punting and you're just letting, you're going to let somebody else take your market share. Like my coach gave me this idea. I mean, this sounds really harsh and I honestly haven't gotten the, I don't know if I should say this, but like, I've been a little reluctant to say this to some of the newer agents, which is this idea of what they call PACE, P-A-C-E. And that's an acronym that talks about primary, alternative, contingency, and emergency. Okay. And this is the idea. Okay. The primary plan. Okay. The primary plan is essentially your 411, right? It is, I make X number of calls a day. I have this number of appointments that I set. I just the normal drill, which by the way, now probably needs to be, you know, you need to push the gas a little harder on that. Okay. The alternative plan is kind of the 15th of the month protocol. So that is essentially, okay, shit, I'm not on pace for my goals and I better do something about it. And as a result, I'm going to lead generate for an extra hour each morning and an extra hour each evening, because I don't want to get into the situation where I can't pay my bills. Right. And I don't want to get into the situation where, you know, I'm reliant on one closing in order to keep me afloat. The contingency plan, for lack of a better way to put it, is like, okay, well, if it's not real estate, like, what are you going to do? Right. And by the way, like, it's not exactly the most stellar job market out there right now either. Right. So if you think you're going to leave real estate and go get a $100,000 job, I don't think that's going to happen. Mm-hmm. Right. So what's your contingency plan? And can you afford the lifestyle that you desire with that contingency plan? And then the E is emergency. Emergency is like, okay, well, I hope that $1,000 check shows up from the government. Like, you know, I'm going to need a bailout essentially. Right. And I'm not getting political. I'm just sharing the facts. I am going to choose to rely on myself and my efforts to create what I'm trying to create, because whatever the government may provide, and quite frankly, most of us couldn't qualify for it anyway.
Exactly. Yeah. Right. Exactly.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. But even if we could, I mean, a one-time payment of $1,200, like,
yeah, it's nothing.
That doesn't even cover my kids' school that they're not going
right.
to.
Right. Right.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. So like, and that's one time, like when the bill comes next month, what am I supposed to do?
Right. Mm-hmm.
And so I'm going to control my bottom line. And the only way I can do that is to wake up early and pour myself into the people that impact my financial bottom line.
Right. That's that 80-20. I mean, I take that to heart every time I think it was, I don't know if it's in my MERA or which one of the two, because I'm reading both of them now, but that, you know, doing 20% to net your 80 is really important. And it's volumes right now. I think that's why I was freaking out over all the meetings and not getting on the phone, because I'm like, I need to get on the phones, you know?
Yeah.
And then when I watch all this stuff, when I'm listening to the KCM, when I'm reading Realtor.com or even the Wall Street Journal and just looking at what's going on, I don't watch too much of the COVID. I dib and dab with that, and then I got to put it aside. It's too depressing.
Yeah.
But even watching the stats with the, you know, CDC and going on the website or even looking at what's happening with the DOL, it's just crazy the amount of impact this is all going to happen. So I think that's where I'm questioning, like, the reality is that we are back in a recession, but it's a different type of recession, again, because it's not based on the financials, but the psychological and emotional side really is dealing with the financial aspects of everybody.
Yeah. I mean, that is the byproduct of a recession, is there's less opportunities in the marketplace for employment, right? Everyone is impacted financially, right? They have less, I shouldn't say everybody, but a lot of people have less revenue.
Right.
Yeah. Right. Many of the expenses that we have committed to live the lifestyle that we want aren't going to change drastically. I mean, you may be able to cut a cell phone bill, or not even a cell phone bill, like a Netflix account, but that's not going to move the needle that much, right? Mm-hmm. So, and now you have less money in the market, right? Everyone's a little scared. So the byproduct of what we're experiencing is very similar. And a lot of us were in the business 10 years ago, and we worked through this.
Mm-hmm. Right. I didn't like it.
Right.
I didn't like it either.
Nobody did.
And there was a lot of scary nights.
Exactly. Oh, yes.
Right. And again, the only defense for that is there are more people in the world that when they have the need to buy or sell homes, they come to you. And, you know, I've been calling some agents, you know, Redfin laid off 41% of their agents. I've been reaching out to some Redfin agents, right?
Yeah.
Right. With all due respect, they've got their head in the sand.
Mm-hmm.
Right. The ones that have lost their job, like, aren't even, they don't even understand, like, the backstory of Redfin.
What happened?
Yeah. Right. And they don't understand, that, like, they don't have a job anymore and they've got a real estate license and that's about the only way they're going to make money, yet they don't have any clients coming to them for, made by somebody else anymore. And the ones that have kept their job don't seem to have any worries about the fact that a bunch of their colleagues just lost theirs.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, I'm like basically on a mission, and I've been on a mission for like 5 years at least to like help agents out there that need the truth to hear the truth.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, it's kind of that simple.
Right.
So I don't mean to scare you guys, but that is why they're talking about doubling down. And again, the only defense for what we're experiencing is more clients. Like Jan and I were talking a few minutes ago, you know, she's got essentially a prospective client that is a total asshole, and he's not listening to anything she says. Well, if that's your only client, then you're going to put up with it because you don't have any choice. If you've got so many clients that you can barely keep them straight, then you have then that conversation is very, very short. Sir, this is the way I operate. This is our next step. Cooperate, yes or no, right? Move on. So if somebody is not respecting you or respecting the boundaries that you've established for your business, which you have, by the way, every right to do so, right? Then don't give that person your time. Because when you say yes to that person, you're saying no to every other prospect that you could have accorded it during that time period. And you're saying no to your family.
Yeah, sometimes you got to be okay with firing people.
Right.
Hell yeah.
Exactly.
Fly on the corner before. But you got to be okay with firing people.
You left somebody on the corner before?
Yeah, I was in Boston and he was just so like irate. I mean, he wanted this property. It was a 3-family and he just knew he could pay this. And I said, no, you know, he didn't qualify for it. And he kept saying, well, you need to get it for me. And he's screaming and hollering. I said, I am not the one. I got in the car and I just left him standing on the corner. I was like, that's it. Because he kept calling me at 3 o'clock in the morning. And I was so desperate. Wow. I was so desperate for the sale because it was $700,000. So I'm like, oh my gosh. So I just kept picking up his phone calls. And, you know, my husband's like, why are you answering your phone at 3? Who's calling you at
3 o'clock?
Like, it's really a client.
Well, you're going to help somebody buy a $700,000 house who actually can't buy a $700,000 house.
Right. I was just so, you know, I was new in the business, but I just
sometimes
got to the point where
even our
like,
brains don't work.
Yeah, I said, that's it. I'm done. You know, not all money's good money, as I say. So that that was my
there
lesson.
There you go. Well, one of the things that
disturb is your friend.
Right. Yeah. Exactly, Pam.
You're absolutely right. 100%. One thing that we're starting to get coached to a little bit is this idea of what they call a 90-day GPS. So your GPS that you created at the beginning of the year that you're working on right now that says, like, okay, I'm going to have this number of units sold and this number of appointments and this number of database ads and all that kind of stuff, they all need to be revisited. Yeah. Right, because you're probably going to have to put in more effort to get those results. That's the first thing. And like if open houses was on your thing, well, you better figure out an alternative to that. If door knocking was on your list, you better figure out an alternative to that. So we need to tweak those, number one. Number two is the next 90 days are going to have an enormous impact on your bottom line, mm-hmm. right? And what you need to accomplish over the next 90 days may be different than what you need to accomplish before the end of the year. And if the next 90 days should be, I mean, this is going to be none of us have fought like we need to fight over the next 90 days in a while, right? business has been relatively easy to come by for the last handful of years, right? We kind of forgot how to handle objections, right? We forgot some of our sales skills. We forgot how to talk to people. We forgot, how to, the disciplines that we have to employ every day, because business was easy. Hey, Alicia, go handle this person, blah, blah, blah. It's easy. Slam dunk. No fighting over commissions, no fighting over anything. Well, we're in a shifted market now. And in a shifted market, the people who don't do the work won't last. And the people who are left, they better have high levels of sales skills and professionalism in order to attract the people that actually do are motivated enough to buy and sell homes. So, I heard a great line about coaching the other day, and they said, you hire a coach to tell you what you don't want to hear so that you can get what you want.
Okay.
Right?
Yep.
It's simply put, right? So, like, you go to the gym and you hire a workout coach, and he's like, all right, you quit eating the French fries, you're never going to lose this weight. Are you clear? Right? Stephanie told me I had to do like 100 sit-ups for every wing that I ate.
So I'm good.
That pissed me off. Right? Well, look, I got to tell you, I sat in that team. I've been in the ALC for a long time. I've sat in the team leader role. I'm still in the leadership team. Like, there are a lot of agents that they can't pay their bill, right? They have to leave the business in the wintertime because they can't pay their board dues, right? We have an opportunity to make hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars, if not more. And all it takes is $110 a month and $400 a year to be a part of ABR, or not ABR, what's it called, ARA? Right? I mean, how lucky are we? But there are literally people that can't put that together. And I don't mean any judgment here, but I just don't want to see anyone in that situation.
Yeah.
Because when they desired to have this wonderful life and to do it by having a real estate license, they didn't want to go back and get a job. They wanted to do this.
Yeah.
Right? What are you guys hearing?
I'm going to make two phone calls before the 11 o'clock call about mortgage forbearance and how to prevent low appraisals.
So I do have on the calendar coffee with Bill, so I'll hop on at 3 for another half hour if anyone wants to hop on and ask anything. What else is on your mind, guys?
I think the real is just real.
Real is real. Yeah. Real is real. And by the way, your clients need to hear it too. Mm-hmm. The transaction that Kathy was referring to earlier this morning, where she did her research and said price is 600 and somebody's saying 709. Like, how can you be that far off?
Yeah.
Right. Real is real. If that agent that actually gets the job does what they're supposed to do, they're going to end up losing their shorts. Right? They're going to pay for fancy photography, fancy staging, and that house is going to sit there. And in 3 months, Kathy's going to swoop in and sell it for them at the price that she told them all along it would sell for.
Yep,
if they're lucky, it may be worth $550 in 6 months.
I know. I left messages for the people that we had talked about. So I'm going to call them back up again because that was such a good point. And thank you for those helpful hints yesterday because I did call them back.
They just got to know.
The 11 o'clock call, is that through Zoom and you sent it to?
That's the normal, that's the normal 11 o'clock,
the normal 11 o'clock. Okay.
Georgia Legacy Group call. Yeah.
Okay. Got it.
Yeah. So it is through Zoom. Yeah.
And right. Aubrey sent an email today with the link in it.
He did. Okay. All right. Cause I definitely
want to. I believe it's the same link every time. Same link every time.
How do I find my NARDS number?
Ask Lucy.
Okay. If you go to NAR though, if you go to NAR and put in your information, it'll tell you your NARS number.
Yeah, I can't sign in because I don't have that either. So
no, but like if you go to NAR, if you go to the, you know, the main website, because I did it yesterday, I needed mine. If you go to the main website, then it says look up agent. Did you try it that way?
Oh.
And if you look up the agent, put in your last name, it'll spit out your NAR's number.
Thank you.
Okay, perfect. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Talk to you guys later. Bye.
All right, guys.
Bye.
Have a great day.